I'd like to request the president of the SCBA, Mr. Dushyant Dave, to come and say a few words on this special occasion for all of us. Mr. Dushyant Dave.
Good afternoon, everybody. My Lord Justice Misra, Mr. Ashok Desai, distinguished seniors and all the colleagues at the bar. I won't take much of your time, but I must express the gratitude towards those who are behind this fantastic movie on Justice Krishna Iyer, one of the greatest doyens. On behalf of the bar, we are grateful that My Lord Justice Misra has kindly agreed to grace this function. And we are also equally grateful to Sri Ashok Desai, who has agreed to speak on Justice Krishna Iyer. So it's we are all looking forward to hearing. We must be reminded of Justice Krishna Iyer again and again, because there is a lot to learn from him, and it's never too late to learn about him. So thank you very, very much, everyone.
May I now request Mr. Ashok Desai, Senior Advocate, to kindly say a few words.
Mr. Justice Misra, my senior and junior colleagues and friends, about 50 years ago, on the 19th of July 1703, two judges were sworn in to join the bench of the Supreme Court. One had come by with a brilliant career, but come the orthodox way. That is Mr. Justice Bhagavati, who was by that time the Chief Justice of Gujarat. The second had a very unorthodox background, namely Mr. Justice Krishna Iyer. He was the first minister in the cabinet of EMS Nambudripad, which you know came to a very abrupt end because of government used 356 for the first time. Then he was on the law commission, then a judge, and thereafter he joined the Supreme Court. I must tell you that his entry was controversial. And I'm in a way sorry to say that many of us thought that with his background, there would be some party orientation. And therefore, the bar actually, there were murmurs at the bar about his appointment. But I must tell you that by his independence, and above all his humanism, we ended up like Goldsmith, namely, those who had come to scoff remain to pray. He has written a large number of books, and it is very impressive that, and perhaps a model for other judges to follow, because he has given his memories of years on the bench. For instance, he writes that on the morning of one morning in late June 1975, Gokhale, who was the law minister, phoned me. And Gokhale was a very amiable lawyer, so naturally his phone was happily received. But he said, Judge, I want to come and see you. So Krishna Iyer didn't follow why the law minister should suddenly come in the morning. On inquiry, he said that Justice Sinha of the High Court has just given a judgment. You are disqualifying Mrs. Gandhi. You are the judge, a vacation judge, and I would like to come and talk about it. So Krishna Iyer said, waste of everyone's time. What I would suggest is, I will keep it, you want prompt hearing, all right, I'll give very prompt hearing. And without, in a mild way, he rebuffed the minister and said, we will go to a hearing quickly. It was a historic hearing. On the one side was Palkhivala, at his best, and the other side was Shanti Bhushan, who was an equally stout opponent. And Palkhivala said that unless you give full stay, and Mrs. Gandhi is allowed to function fully in Parliament, any mere limited stay would affect the credibility of the Indian government. Therefore, you should not follow the normal practice, which you all recall. Normal is to say that the seat will not be vacated. The gentleman in question or the lady here would attend Parliament, but would not vote and would not speak, and would not draw the salary. Mrs. Gandhi, he said, I'll give modified to an extent that she can speak as the Prime Minister, but she will not vote and she will not draw salary. Nani had put the case so high on the legitimacy of the government that the fact that this was limited stay was given was ultimately used by her critics to bring her down, and she then declared emergency in 2 or 3 days. And I used to tell Krishna Iyer that we all looked upon him as a great defender of civil liberties, but perhaps his judgment was responsible for the emergency and what followed thereafter. You had at that time, you must now think of the institution, the triumvirate of judges, 3 judges, who gave a new direction and new to the Supreme Court and perhaps brought in what may be called new jurisprudence. Senior-most was Bhagwati, second was Krishna Iyer, and third was Desai. And what had happened in a way was, D.A. Desai, what had happened in a way was that the bar, all of us included, were very critical of the conduct of the Supreme Court during the emergency, which exceptions like Khanna and Krishna Iyer seemed to be compliant with the desires of the executive. Therefore, a new jurisprudence was started, in a way, emphasizing civil and economic rights. And this whole change which has come across in judgments, date from the time of this what I call the triumvirate, which then expanded individual rights, made procedure subservient to the need of the litigant. And Krishna himself contributed a great deal to it, including on the PIL, on which he had given a report, and of course his views on capital punishment and views for aiding the unaided litigant. He became an underdog judge, and one way to argue before him, we were much younger at that time, and one way to argue before him is to make out some way of persuading him that you are appearing for the underdog. And I was appearing in Shetty's case, which you remember, laid down some principles of arbitrariness for admission. And he said, what is all this fashionable lawyers coming to argue about hotel owners? So I said, Lordship has not seen the title. It is Shetty. So he said, so what? I said, Shetty are the only people who give 8 and a tea in Bombay. Everybody else charges 5 rupees and 10 rupees. And he said, is that so? He inquired with his colleague, who was the judge. And he said, I think we must consider this matter. And then the rest, of course, was... But I must also tell you that he was very fond of colorful language. And sometimes it became a little difficult to compress. He compressed his thought by extending it. I remember in Shamshir Singh, you remember, he laid down what has become now a basic doctrine in India, that the president is like the queen and not like the president of America, our president. This is what he wanted to say. So now Krishna Iyer could have been put in simple ways. But I remember citing this passage against a serial in Bombay, and the exact language was that it is not the Potomac but the Thames which fertilizes the flow of Yamuna. What is now Potomac is a river on which Washington, the city of Washington, is located. So when I cited this, my opponent said, my lord, I don't know who this Potomac is, and why my learned friend is citing Potomac, I don't know what it has to do with it. So Krishna Iyer used very colorful language. Sometimes it brought home exactly the nuances he wanted to develop. So for years he became the sentinel of our liberty and a judge. He saw to it that liberty was not eroded in the way that he could, like principles like bail and not jail, etc., were principles which he laid down. But after retirement, for 40 years, he acted, in my view, as the conscience of our society. See, very, very many times when judges retire, there are greener pastures which they look to, and legitimately, nothing wrong with that. But Krishna Iyer was keen to continue, as I mentioned, as a sentinel of our liberties, and mention and show injustice wherever he could. And I must add, he did not bother about what the view of the establishment was. Establishment means even establishment not only in the political sense, but even in the legal sense or the judicial sense. He gave voice to his thoughts, sometimes he would disagree, but he was there as our sentinel and our conscience, and we must remember him with gratitude on a day like this. Thank you. Mr. Dave, President of the Board, Mr. Sinha, Mr. Bhatia, Mr. Desai, who has stolen my thoughts recently, ladies and gentlemen. Emerson was writing something on a paper. An idea came to him. While penning the idea, he was so hurt, he wrote, "All my good ideas are stolen by my ancients. So what I intended to speak have been stolen by Mr. Desai partly. So I will not hold him responsible for the whole theft." When I was invited to address, I said, "I'm not going to address, not that you have to be an ancillary, a step-in speaker." I said, "Doesn't matter, then I'll go." You see, you don't discuss judgments of Justice Krishna because the entire bar knows what judgments have been given and what he intended to say, what principles have been laid. Definitely, you don't come and address the Supreme Court bar about the judgments of the Krishna judge at the capital. I thought, how shall I convey my thoughts in a span of 10 minutes to the members of the bar who know more than me about Krishna Earth? And as he has said, he must have seen, I had only seen him once in Kerala in a meeting. You see, after he retired, he wrote one line, "A human being, a person, cannot be made an unperson." Please mark this line. A person cannot be converted to an unperson. Unperson is grammatically an error, but it has Himalayan effect. It has Everestian effect. You don't say a human being becomes inhuman. You don't say he becomes an alien. You use the word unperson because there cannot be any personality without the person, and the elementary rights of a person are his humanity, his individuality, his liberty, everything included. One word expresses the sea of thought. This is actually a legal metaphor, a legal image, a legal symbol like potomac. The Krishna was a master of images, symbols, and metaphors. Now, look at certain combination of words. I told you from the very beginning, I'm not going to analyze the legal principles. That's another art of organizer. Yes, I had come across a phrase. Homogeneity. Homogeneity all of us know. But he says in this Rahim Khan judgment, homogenization of Indian society has to lead to political purity. Why this word homogenization? It's because when you say homogeneity, it conveys a different idea. When you talk about an homogenization, it's a noun. It really